Yeah. Okay, so the next topic we are going to start is collision theory of reaction. See, according to this concept, for the completion of any reaction or for any reaction to proceed, we basically have two hurdles, we can say, or two barriers, we can say, which every reaction has to fulfill, otherwise the reaction is not possible. Okay, so we know when A and B are reacting together, right, A and B are reacting together and it forms a product. So the hurdles or the barrier that we are talking about is, first of all, when A and B reacts, there are collisions between A and B. Correct? So we have AA molecules and BB molecules. So both A and B molecules, they collide. Suppose this is A and this is B. Both collides with each other. And if this collision is effective, okay, this gives a collision. This collision gives you the product, provided they have the sufficient energy. Okay. Now this collision, if you talk about here, collision, we have two types. Here also we have collision. One is effective collision and another one is non-effective collision. Non-effective collision. What is effective and non-effective collision, we'll discuss. See, when the two molecules collides, we know at the surface of the molecules, we have certain active surface area, correct? So to provide the product, we must have active surface area into contact when the molecules collides. Okay, that is one of the criteria, not the only criteria. That is one of the criteria, but important criteria. Without this also, the reaction is not possible. So we are going to discuss about the two barriers here. Both barriers are equally important in order to give the product, right? If one barrier is not there, one condition is not satisfied, product won't form. Okay, so basically in all reaction, we know reactant molecules collides and it gives product. All those collisions which gives product are called effective collisions. Okay, we can have n number of collisions, but it is not necessary that all the collisions will give you the product. So the collisions which gives you the product here, that collision we call it as effective collision. In effective collision, we get product. If the collision is non-effective, then the product won't form. No product. Now for a collision to be effective, we have that two barriers that must be satisfied. Okay. The two barriers that we have, we call it as, the first one is orientation barrier. Orientation barrier. And energy barrier. Orientation barrier and energy barrier. If both conditions are satisfied, then only the collision is effective and product forms. Okay. So before going into this, just one few small term we'll see, that we call it as collision frequency. So first you write down the heading here. Collision frequency. Write down. It is the number of collision it is the number of collision takes place per unit time, per unit volume of the reaction mixture. Represented by Z, and don't get confused with compressibility factor. Okay. Number of collision takes place per unit time, per unit volume of the reaction mixture. Reaction mixture. Next, write down, all collision does not bring a chemical change. Chemical change means formation of product. Does not bring a chemical change. Next. The collision which produces a chemical change is called effective collision, right? And those who does not bring a chemical change, non-effective collision. One more point. There are two barriers which are need to be cleared, in order to provide effective collision. Okay. Now the first point, two barriers we have, both are important. Okay. It's like only one barrier is there, only one barrier is satisfied, other one is not satisfied, then also the reaction, the collision won't be effective. Okay. So both are equally important. You'll get theoretical questions on this, which statement is right or wrong like that. Okay. So the first barrier that we have, write down, it is orientation barrier. Orientation barrier means what? The molecules which collides, the reacting molecules, write down, reacting molecules must have a proper orientation. Like I said, the active surface area must involve in the collision, right? So reacting surface area must have proper, sorry, reacting molecules, what I am writing it down. Reacting molecules must have must have proper orientation. Orientation. Without proper orientation, the reaction is very difficult to proceed because the active surface area is not taking part in the collision, right? So orientation is very important. Suppose A and B, if two molecules are colliding, so they will have an intermediate where A bond is about to break, BB bond is about to break, and AB bond is about to form. And then eventually what happens, AA and BB bond breaks, we'll get AB and AB. This is the product we get, provided the other barrier, other condition is satisfied. If the other condition is not satisfied here, this intermediate forms and then it's converted back into the reactant. This cannot be the final product, never. This will form, either it will convert into the product, final product, or it will convert back into the reactant. This won't be there because it is an activated complex. It has the maximum energy, highly unstable. So this we can say it is an activated complex we have. The peak of the graph. Done. Now, the next one we have here, energy barrier. Energy barrier, right on to this. If you look at this graph, similar kind of graph we have discussed in Maxwell distribution curve, if you remember. This side we have fraction of molecule, the y-axis. Molecules. And this side we have energy axis. Fraction of molecule energy, right? So the graph goes like this. Okay. So all these molecules we have, okay. But it's not like all the molecules, obviously it represents what? The fraction of molecules. Just a second. One second, guys. Correct. So all these fraction of molecules, this represents what? This represents the energy of the various fractions. Like if the fraction is this, you know, the energy is this, and like this we have. The energy is this and so on, right? So all these energies, we should have a minimum amount of energy, like energy, for a collision to be effective. It's not like this fraction of molecule has certain energy, this fraction of molecule has certain energy, and all these molecules will provide, you know, the effective collision. So the minimum amount of energy that is required for the collision to be effective, that energy we call it as threshold energy. Okay, so suppose I'm assuming the threshold energy is this. This is the ET we have. ET stands for, T stands for threshold energy, right? So corresponding to this energy, the fraction that we have, you see this? This is a fraction of molecule. Right, this energy. So all those molecules which has energy below this threshold energy will not provide effective collision. Collision will be there, but those collisions are non-effective collision. Okay, so all molecules, all fraction of molecules which are towards the right of this, right side of this threshold energy provides the effective collisions. These are the fraction of molecules which provides effective collision. Write down fraction of molecules which provides effective collision, provided the fact that orientation barrier is there, right? That barrier is already, you know, is satisfied. Effective collision. Okay, this energy ET, write down here, it is a threshold energy. Threshold energy. Write down the definition of threshold energy first of all. So threshold energy ET, write down, it is the minimum amount of energy amount of energy which colliding molecule must possess to make chemical reaction possible. Right? This is threshold energy. Next line, write down all these, you know, things you will get theoretical questions. Okay, that's why I'm writing down each and every point here so that you also write it down. Okay, a collision between high energy molecule forms an unstable molecular cluster called activated complex. Called activated complex. Right, this is highly unstable, it is written already. Hence, the lifespan of these complexes is very small. And further, these complexes activated complex breaks into either the reactants or a new substance called product. Right. So either this activated complex will convert back into the reactant or it converts into the product. Okay. The energy associated with activated complex is called activation energy. Write down the last point. The energy associated with activated complex is called activation energy. Okay, copy this. The last thing is the graph we need to see for this. Two graphs we have. First, we'll discuss the first one, and similarly, you can understand the second one also. Okay, so this y-axis is the energy, x-axis is the progress of reaction. Progress of reaction. So the graph would be like this. We have reactant, and with reactant, the molecule collides, energy increases, and then it comes down. Right? So this, you see, this peak that we have here is the activated complex. No, we don't have any, you know, concluding facts for that triple. We can have any energy. The purpose is that the energy provides the cluster, the unstable cluster that you have. Because if these two molecules collide, whether they have the same energy or different energy, less or more, but when collision takes place, it should form this. If this does not form, no matter what the energy we have, low or high, equal or not equal, that does not make any sense. Okay. The reason is they collide and they should provide this minimum amount of energy so that it converts into the product.
Yes, sir.
We can have any combination in that. Okay. So this point, the peak that you have, is called activated complex. Activated complex. Okay. This is reactant. This is product. Okay, and this energy, the energy of activated complex, okay, this energy gap, this energy gap from the product to activated complex, this energy gap from reactant to activated complex, okay, this we call it as activation energy EA for forward reaction, reactant to activated complex. This is activation energy for backward reaction. Okay, and this gap that you have, this energy gap, wait, from the reactant to product, this energy gap that we have, this energy gap is called the enthalpy of the reaction, delta H or delta E. The definition of delta H or delta E, the mathematical relation we have, it is defined as the activation energy for forward reaction minus the activation energy for backward reaction. Obviously, if you look at this difference here, activation energy for backward reaction is more than this. So delta H or delta E is coming out to be negative, and hence the reaction is exothermic in nature. So this graph is for exothermic reaction. Okay, obviously the reactant energy is more than the product energy. So this amount of energy has been released. Okay, so this we call it as one more small thing here, you see. This generally we call it as activation energy, correct? Forward to backward activation energy is this, plus the potential energy of the reactant molecule, right? This is EA plus the potential energy of the reactant molecule. This sum is the threshold energy. It is coming out to be this only. So there's a relation, and on this relation also they ask question in the exam. The relation is, here I'll draw one more graph here, or I'll write on this only way. The relation is threshold energy is equals to the potential energy of reactant plus the activation energy. So when you solve question any book, you'll get one question based on this relation. Threshold energy is equals to this and this. They'll give you activation energy is equals to this minus this. This kind of question you will get. Okay. Threshold energy, one point you must remember, it is independent of temperature. Independent of temperature and fixed for a reaction. It won't change. Fixed for a reaction. That's why if you recall this fact that we had discussed in grade 11 also, if you increase the temperature, and this graph, if you draw at higher temperature, I'm just drawing here to make you understand. The graph, if you draw at higher temperature, the curve becomes flat, like this it goes, and it goes like this. Yes or no, did you remember this? Oh, just a second. Goes like this and it comes like this. Okay, you see the threshold energy is same only, it is not changing. Threshold energy is still this, but the graph shifts towards the right. So more number of molecules we have which can provide effective collagen. That's why at higher temperature, you know, the rate of reaction increases because the collagen frequency has been increased, right? So ET, the threshold energy, it won't change with temperature. Whatever temperature you have, it will be same, and it is fixed for a reaction. Understood this point? Any doubt?
Clear, sir.
Yes, sir.
Now, this you can also draw for endothermic. The graph will be exactly opposite, right? If you look at this graph, I'm just drawing it for endothermic. The energy of product will be more than to that of reactant. Okay, so the graph of endothermic reaction. All the x's are same, so it will go like this. Product, reactant. This is the activation energy backward. This is the activation energy forward. This difference is the delta H, and delta H is positive, reaction is exothermic. Clear? Then
1 minute, sir.
Done?
Yes, sir.
Venkat, finished?
Finished, sir, finished.
I'm waiting for you only. Okay, so this is it. We are done with this chapter almost. Okay, but like for exams like JEE or NEET, especially JEE, okay, these are the 2-3 types of reactions and some calculation we are going to do now. Okay. This most probably they won't ask you in NEET, okay, but for JEE it is important. The derivation is quite big. Okay, you cannot do this derivation in the examination hall because of the, you know, because the space is not there that much. Or nowadays they are providing sheet, but obviously it will take time. Derivation is not tough. You can easily do this. It's just an application of, you know, integration and all. You can easily do this. But if you can memorize the final formula, then it will save a lot of time in the exam. Okay, so here we are going to derive each and everything we are going to derive. But I would suggest if you can memorize this, that will be, you know, better. Three types of reaction we have. Calculations we are going to do on this: sequential reaction, parallel reaction, and reversible reaction. Okay, so first of all, we are going to discuss sequence reaction. Sequence reaction means what? One reactant is giving a product, and that product is again forming one more product. Like for example, you see, we have a reaction A gives B, and B is again converting into C. This kind of reaction is there. Rate constant, I'm assuming for the first step, it is K1 and then it is K2. Okay. So what we are going to find out in this, each and every step you look at properly, otherwise you'll get confused. So at time t is equals to zero, the initial concentration is A naught. This is zero and this is zero. At time t is equals to t, we have a certain concentration of A at time t, of B it is Bt at time t, and C it is Ct. One more thing, if I write simply like this A, it is a concentration of A at any time t. So whether I write this or this, both are same thing you take care of. Correct? Similarly for B and C also. So we need to find out in this, what is this concentration at any time t? What is the concentration of B at any time t? What is the concentration of C at any time t? This is the three things we need to find out. And apart from this, we need to find out also what is the B max concentration? What is the maximum concentration of B? And at what time? And at what time concentration of B becomes B max? Did you understand?
Yes.
Right? What are the things we need to find out? AT, BT, CT plus at what time, since A is converting into B, correct? So B is forming, and the moment B forms, it starts converting into C also. So we'll definitely have a point where the B concentration is maximum, and beyond that, the concentration of B cannot be, and it converts into C, correct? So one by one, we are going to discuss this. Did you copy this?
One second.
Okay. See, first of all, and all these are first order reaction we are assuming, correct? First order reaction. So rate of disappearance of A, rate of A, what is that? It is minus of D concentration of A by dt. Okay, minus of D concentration of A by dt is equals to the rate constant K1 into concentration of A to the power 1, right? So from this, we can find out the concentration of A at any time t, that is A0 e to the power minus K1 t. Any doubt, respond, all of you, please, what about this? Any doubt on this? AT we got, because A naught will be given, AT we got. Okay, now for B, you see what we need to do. Rate of formation of B, I am writing it down. What I am writing, rate of formation of B. That would be what? The rate at which A is disappearing. So it is rate of disappearance of A, bracket close. Rate of disappearance of A is nothing but the rate of formation of B, but at the same time, B is also converting into A. So rate of disappearance of A minus rate of disappearance of B. Is it fine? Yes. Net rate of formation of B is this one. The rate at which B is forming minus the rate at which B is disappearing.
Yes, sir.
Correct. So the rate of formation of B is equals to what we can write? Minus D by DT of B is equals to, oh, it is plus, no. Plus of D by DT of B is equals to rate of disappearance of A is minus K1 into A. Minus K2 into B. Oh, I think it should be plus, no? Because minus dA by dt is k1a, correct? Minus dA by dt is k1a, minus dV by dt is k2b. Any doubt? Tell me.
No, sir.
Correct. So we can write this as dB by dt is equals to K1 into A minus K2 into B. It's all about mathematics. There is nothing chemistry into this. Kuch bhi chemistry nahi hai. Right, just need to solve this differential equation, that is it. Okay, so what we can do here, you see, we have d concentration of B by dt plus K2 concentration of B is equals to K1, and concentration of A, we have A0 e to the power minus K1t, correct? Yes.
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Now we need to solve this. What we'll do? To solve this, I'll just multiply here e to the power k2t here, and this side also e to the power k2t. Now, could you tell me what is this entire term on the left hand side?
A differential equation.
Can I write this entire term as d by dt of concentration of B into e to the power k to t? Can I write this du into v by dx?
Yes.
Yes. Sir. Yes. So we get this. And on the right hand side, see, maybe you find this derivation is complex because there are so many terms, but the result that you get, it's very, small and beautiful result. You can easily memorize that expression. It's very symmetrical, you will see. Okay, so maybe the derivation is, there are so many terms and you are finding it complex now, but the result is very simple and clean. Okay, this side, what we get, K1, A0, e to the power, what we can write? E to the power k2 minus k1 into t. Now you just dt, you take it that side and differentiate and integrate it. So what we can write next? D concentration of B e to the power k2 t is equals to k1 a0 e to the power k2 minus k1 into t dt, and then we'll integrate it. Clear? Copy this down. Done. Can I move on?
Yes, sir.
So once we finish this class, okay, at least after the class, you have your dinner. And after that, just sit for 15, 20 minutes, half an hour, and do this derivation on your own once. Right. Okay. After this, you see, when you integrate this, we get on the left hand side, it is concentration of B e to the power k2t is equals to, we get k2 minus k1 into dt we have, no? So we'll multiply by this. So we'll have k1 a0 we already have. Okay. And the integration of this would be e to the power k2 minus k1 into t divided by k2 minus k1 plus c. Is it fine? Yes.
Yes, sir.
If you get the C, we can substitute C and we can find out the concentration of B. Yes, no? So what is the condition we can apply to find out C? Condition is what? At time t is equals to zero, what is the concentration of B? Yes, there's no B present initially. We'll substitute it here. So we'll get what? C is equals to K1 by this side it becomes zero. So K1 minus K2, can I write down this directly? Because if it comes this side, we'll have a negative sign. I'll take it inside here. Into A naught, is it fine?
Yes.
Okay. Now we'll substitute this C here and find out B. So B into concentration of B into e to the power K2T is equals to K2 minus K1 into A naught e to the power K2 minus K1 into T plus C is K1 minus K2 into A naught. Okay, here we have K2 minus K1, K1 minus K2. So what I'll do, I'll take this common K1 by K2 minus K1 A naught. I take this as common. So it becomes e to the power K2 minus K1 into T minus 1. Fine. Bolo.
Yes, sir.
Are you getting it, all of you?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now what I'll do, I'll take this e to the power K2T because B we need to find out. So anyways, we have to take this side in the denominator. This e to the power K2T, I'll divide it here. This, you keep it as it is. This, you divide it this side. And then you open this bracket also, e to the power K2T into e to the power minus K1T, you will get an expression over there. That's what I'm going to do now. You see, concentration of B is equals to K1 by K2 minus K1 into A naught. And inside the bracket, we have e to the power K2T into e to the power minus K1T minus one divided by e to the power K2T, bracket close. Now we'll divide this e to the power K2T in both the terms. So what we get? K1 by K2 minus K1 A naught, open bracket, e to the power minus K1T minus e to the power minus K2T. Okay. So concentration of B here is equals to K1 by K2 minus K1 A naught, open bracket. See, K1 here in the numerator. So here you start with K1 and then you write down K2. The result will be symmetrical. You can memorize this. This is the concentration of B at any time T. Everything will be given in the question. You solve some advanced level assignment, you'll get questions on this, and you will realize once you know the final answer, final formula, you can do these questions in seconds. Otherwise, you have to derive all this, and mind my words, this kind of derivation in the exam under pressure, you will definitely do wrong somewhere. And you never know if, like, it's there in the syllabus, they can ask you this question, right? So this is BT. Now, what is important, what kind of question that they have asked, I'll tell you in the last, but let's finish it first, right? So this is BT, we have already calculated A, C we need to find out. So C easily you can find out by mass balance, okay? So by mass balance, you see what we can do because A is the only one which is converting into B and C. So we can, anytime we can balance the mass. By mass balance, what we can write, that concentration of A initial, that is A naught, is equals to the concentration of A, B, and C at any time, because from A only it is B and C it is forming, right? This relation is true at all the time. A concentration, you know, A naught e to the power minus k1t, B just now you have calculated, and A naught is A naught only. So if you subtract this A naught minus A minus B, you will get C. So I'm just giving you this expression here, final expression of C, and this they haven't asked till date, the concentration of C. The point is, A you don't have to memorize, you have to memorize only B. Once you know B, if they ask you C, you can subtract and you can find out C also. So concentration of C, if you solve this method I told you, A naught open bracket 1 minus e to the power minus k1t comes from this A, and then B it would be k1 by k2 minus k1, and since I start with k1, so we'll write down first e to the power minus k1t minus e to the power minus k2t. This is the concentration of C at any time. What next we need to find out?
B max.
Concentration of B max and time, at what time the concentration of B becomes maximum. Okay, B max, you can simply apply the mathematical thing and you can find out the concentration of B max. See, the concentration of B is this. If you differentiate this and equate to zero, you'll find out the time at which B becomes maximum. Yes or no?
Or when rate of formation of B from A equal to disappearance for C, no sir?
What?
Sir, will it be max when rate of formation of B equal to disappearance of B?
Oh, that condition we can find out. No, that we cannot say. Depends.
Oh, okay, sir. Okay.
Because it depends upon A, B. It's a general expression, no? So if obviously we can say the rate of B will be maximum, when rate of A to B is more and B to C is less. That is a general thing we can say, but that, you know, won't lead you anywhere, leads you anywhere, correct?
Oh, okay.
So just let it be. We need to find out the time at which B becomes maximum. So what we are going to do, we are going to differentiate this and equate it to zero, right? So you see what we are getting here. So expression of B, we have expression of B, C, we'll start with K1. So K1 by K2 minus K1, A naught we have, open bracket, e to the power minus K1t minus e to the power minus K2t. Okay. Now, when you differentiate this, you'll get a very beautiful expression here. Okay. Don't worry that we'll get a complex expression. Very simple expression, very symmetrical expression you'll get. All these things are constant. So I'll write down this as it is. K1 by K2 minus K1 A naught. And this, when you differentiate, you will get minus k1 e to the power minus k1 into t plus k2 e to the power minus k2 into t. Fine, no doubt into this. And when you equate this to zero, what we can write? K2 e to the power minus k2t is equals to k1 e to the power minus k1t. So we'll have K2 by K1 is equals to e to the power K2 minus K1 into T. Now look at this expression. If you take ln both side, ln of K2 by K1 is equals to K2 minus K1 into T. So time at which B becomes maximum is ln K2 by K1 divided by K2 minus K1. This question they have asked many times in the exam. Find out the time at which the concentration of B becomes maximum. You see, nothing is required. K1, K2 will be given. You just need to substitute and find out the answer in 2 seconds. You understood this? Yes, ln K2 minus ln K1 by K2 minus K1. This is the expression we have. Now, again, when you substitute this T there in the concentration of B, you'll get the maximum B. Yes.
So can you scroll up with that?
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Done.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I'll take 5 more minutes. We'll finish it off. Okay. So you see, calculation of Bmax. So Bmax equals to, we have K1 by K2 minus K1 A0, open bracket, e to the power minus k1t. So k1t is ln k2 by k1 divided by k2 minus k1 minus e to the power minus k2 ln k2 by k1 divided by k2 minus k1. This is also looking like very complex, but again, you'll get a very simple expression in the last. Okay. Now you see, if I write down this expression as K1 by K2 minus Siddharth, did you get the expression? Can I write this as K2 by K1 to the power minus K1 by K2 minus K1? Is it fine? Tell me yes, quickly. Or this would be K2 by K1 minus K2 by K2 minus K1. Can we write this?
Yes, sir.
Yes, just this will go up and e to the power ln e something. So that expression will have here. No doubt in this, all of you? Correct. Now, what you do, you just take the LCM and thus you solve this. This expression will get cancelled. K1 by K2 minus K1 A0. When you take this in the denominator and you multiply this here, so can I write this as K2 by K1 to the power K2 minus K1 by K2 minus K1 minus 1. And the entire thing is divided by K2 by K1 to the power K2 by K2 minus K1, bracket close. Is this fine? Tell me.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Pratham is fine. Tripan, Anirudh,
yes, sir.
Anjali, no doubt.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. No doubt.
Okay. A simple. It's not tough. Bhi nahi hai. Expression looks like a bit tough, but it's not that tough. Ye cancel ho gaya. Okay. Now, when you take this LCM here, so it becomes this numerator. You see, it becomes K2 minus K1 by K1. Correct. So the expression here would be K1 by K2 minus K1 A0, and this numerator would be K2 minus K1 by K1, and this expression we can write K2 by K1 in the numerator whole to the power minus of K2 by K2 minus K1. Fine. I have taken this in the numerator, so negative sign here. This LCM you take, so K2 minus K1 by K1 is this. Correct, no doubt, right? This K1 will get cancelled. K2 minus K1, K2 minus K1 will get cancelled. So the expression of B max the final expression is, we have K2 divided by K1 whole to the power minus of K2 by K2 minus K1 A0. This is the final expression for Bmax. And this is it. You see, it's no, when you you know, memorize this result, one more thing you have to take care of, that the reaction was this, A to B and B to C. So it is K2 and this is K1. So B max, so B ka rate constant we are taking here, K2 by K1, K2 by K2 minus K1. So with respect to this only, you memorize all the results that we have done. Right? Any doubt in this? So two things they have asked in this. They have asked this Bmax to find out and the time at which the concentration of B becomes maximum. Okay, so concentration of B, if you don't remember, fine, let it be. But that is the only one thing that you have to keep in mind. Okay, but Bmax and T, you must remember. Right. T also, T also, you see, we have got the value of T. We have K2 by K1. So K1, K2 is what? K1, K2, K2 is for B to C, K1 is for this. So with respect to this only, all the relation you remember. Okay, fine. So this is it. One last thing, just one last minute. Okay, I just finished this one last minute. The graph of this, okay, because graph based question also they have asked once. Okay, so graph of this is, we have concentration of A, concentration of A decreases with time. Okay, so A will keep on decreasing. So this is what we have A. There was this question, which graph is not correct? So this is concentration A naught we have. So it decreases and it goes like this. This is A. And C concentration is increasing continuously. So C was initially zero, C increases like this. It won't go beyond A naught, so take care of that. C goes beyond this, okay? B will be what? At one point, B becomes maximum. So the graph of B would be like this. It could be go like this and then it comes down. So remember, none of this graph will go beyond this maximum value of A, that is A naught. Based on this, they have asked question once. Okay, so because A naught is the maximum concentration, with A naught only B and C is forming, correct? So the graph cannot exceed or, you know, go beyond this line, okay? The blue one is for B, yellow is for C, white is for A, continuously decreases, and the point at which, you know, the concentration of B becomes maximum, this T is, this is the time axis we have, this T is equals to ln K2 by K1 divided by K2 minus K1, corresponding to this point. Here, this one is the Bmax we have. This is it for this. Any doubt in this? Okay, so today after the dinner, you just go through it once, the entire derivation. I would suggest you should do it on your own. Once you do it, you will memorize it. Correct? Like this, we have two more derivation. One is for parallel reaction and other one is for reversible reaction. So next class, we'll finish this. What all chapters we are left with after this?
DF block.
Yes. Okay, fine. No issue. Chalo, theek hai. We'll see you next class. We'll decide something else. Fine, guys. Take care. Bye.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.